Welcome once again in the garage. Today, let's look into how the Weber manual would suggest I would fit jets and everything to the Angry Giulietta in this setup. And then we'll compare with the actual setup. The car is seeing some use in this summertime. It's all dusty. There it is, the engine. Let's look at the numbers that we'll use to look through all the tables and graphs in the Weber manual. But before we start, I'd like to recommend three channels on YouTube for Weber carburetors. One is Weber Performance Carburetors. They're in Australia and they give very short and precise information about the parts. And another is, of course, Jethro Brunner of South Africa. He's very accurate also in his experience of how he works with alphas, and he has some very beautiful videos about refurbishing carburetors. And the third really good information of channel of information is a guy in Belgium called D3 Shooter, and he also has some Weber experience from fiddling with the Triumphs and cars as such. Look into those, they're very good videos. So this is the Weber tuning manual. It's been out for forever, really. It's been published, this is the latest version, but it's a very old publication. And of course, nothing has changed since Eduardo Weber invented the Weber carburetor many years ago. It tells in general about combustion engines and all kinds of facts about how carburetors work, any carburetor really. Part, throttle, full throttle, idle, progression, everything. And the many first pages here are just general ideas about how you can make your carburetor more and more complicated, and some details about how the specific components they work and what the characteristics are. Then comes the DCOE. Actually, this is the DCOE, and it begins to talk about all the values and parameters you can change. And when I first read this this booklet, I just skimmed through it and I thought I got it. Then I visited it again and read everything thoroughly, and twice or three times, because there's a lot of information in every word, in every sentence. So if you read it, read everything and take your time, because all the information is actually hidden inside the text. And it says a lot about the sequence of doing things and how everything is influencing everything, really. And that's part of the secret of carburetors. It then ends with these pages and going over again and generalizing again. And then it talks about different setups, as you can see. Throttle linkage. There, all kinds of different stuff. And then we have here are air horns. Exploded view drawings of the DCOE and all the other carburetors, the DCNF, IDF, and what have we. There's the big DCOE 45. And at the end, there are some different values for different types of jets and stuff, and drawings of all the special parts you can purchase from Weber. And buying Weber, there's a place in Britain called Del Auto Weber. I think this is the official Weber company, actually. And you can buy everything from them. Okay, let's look into our case. First page about the DCOE. It actually says in the book, 40 DCOE carburetor adjusting settings example. This is a horizontal or side draft carburetor having two identical barrels with a synchronized throttles fitted as a dual unit application on a four cylinder, two carburetors, 1300 cc engine providing 90 horsepower at 6000 rpm. Sounds familiar? It is a sports car power plant on which each carburetor barrel supplies fuel independently to one cylinder. Right. And then they have a setup example here. 29 millimeter main Venturi, 4.5 millimeter auxiliary, main jets 1.1, correction air jets 2.0, F16 tube. Then an F50 F11 idle jet. Acceleration 35, 70 for the flowback. Then a 0.20 cc stroke for the pump. And then choke, I don't use a choke. And needle valve would be 1.5. And then the fuel level, that's with a brass float, 8.5. And the weight of the load, 26 grams. No air horns. So this is what Weber would actually suggest for a 1300 Giulietta engine. Well, mine is a little different. This graph is all about selecting the right Venturi, depending on if you want your peak performance as high as 10,000 RPM or as low as 6,000 RPM. The example we just saw was following this line for 6,000 RPM. We calculate the single cylinder capacity and we can say I want my peak performance at between 6 and 8, somewhere in this area. Let's look at that. So mine is a 1430 cc engine that gives me 357.5 cc per cylinder. Let's say 360, or a little more than 350, interpolating between 6 and 8,000 RPM, says that I should actually have a 34 millimeter main Venturi. But 34 millimeters is actually quite big. It says here that you could have the barrel diameter times 0.7 to 0.9 as recommended. That'll be 28 to 36, and that would place 34 right at the top end. In this table it says that the DCOE is ranged from 24 to 36 for standard chokes, main Venturis. I think we should try and go a little lower. Take the graph again and lower our expectations a little bit, getting a little nearer the 6,000 RPM line. We would maybe arrive at 32 millimeter main Venturi, like this, right? A Venturi is a well-calculated and a regulated way of increasing airspeed in a calibrated way. We have air running through a channel here, and a true Venturi has a circular shape here first. It accelerates the air, so the airspeed have to go up from here to here. And a circle is the best way to do that without any drag losses. And then it has to expand. It doesn't have to expand, but we expand the air again afterwards, and the airspeed goes down again. And the best way to do that is to just have a straight taper. So this is the Venturi shape. When the airspeed goes up, the air pressure lowers, and that's what generates a vacuum in this area. So if you drill a hole through the Venturi and we have fuel on top, it'll be sucked in through that vacuum. Because of the pressure difference in this area to the, everything else around here, atmospheric pressure. It's simple physics. The Venturi shape was invented by a guy called Venturi in Italy, of course. And then there's the auxiliary or secondary Venturi. This is from the DCOE. It distributes emulsion from the main circuit. And it sits in front. This is the auxiliary Venturi here. You can recognize the main Venturi. It has a little extra Venturi in order to create a very controlled area, because the vacuum inside this extra Venturi is actually sucked from this area also. It has the deepest vacuum in the main Venturi, and this is what actually pulls in the fuel and air emulsion from the emulsion tube through this channel. And what does the Weber manual has to say about that? It says that for the normal range, so the normal range would be here somewhere, maybe between, let's say 26 and 35 maybe or something. For that range, you would usually have between 3 and 5 millimeter channel size here, because you can buy them with different channel sizes. So I'd say 4.5 maybe, that's a standard size. 4.5 suits a 32 in a 40 millimeter Weber. It also says that you can have a special auxiliary Venturi with a longer tube that sticks out in the front. Maybe you've seen this on old race car from the 1950s and 60s, especially Maseratis, I think I saw that. It sucks in air from a more stable environment here, because as you might have seen in another video of mine or somewhere else, there's a pulsation going on back and forth here from the valves open and closing in the cylinder head. So there's a very violent pulsation at some specific RPM here, and this longer tube can stabilize the pressure, or the vacuum rather, inside the auxiliary Venturi. But that's a special solution. I think I'll go with a 4.5. Okay, these are the auxiliary Venturis, and we have the 40 DCOE. There are 5 types. Or rather, you can have 3.5, 4.5, and there's the extended type. The suggestion of Mr. Weber, the sequence is that we look at the main jet, the fuel jet sitting at the lower end of the emulsion tube. The common range is 0.8 to 1.8 millimeter. It says a lot about careful choice, depending on all kinds of other parameters. And it also says that if you increase the Venturi diameter by 1 millimeter, you should also increase the main jet the diameter by 0.05 millimeter. But there's also a graph. This graph says for a 32 millimeter Venturi that there's a range giving us between 1.5 and 1.95. And then there's a bit of explanation about how many cylinders will be fed by each barrel in the carburetor. And if you have one barrel per cylinder, you need to multiply this number by 0.75. So let's try that. That's the range, usual range, and these are the numbers multiplied by 0.75 gives us 1.15 to 1.45 millimeter. And right in the middle, we have 130, that's 1.30. Now it also says in the text that we should start in the upper end and maybe move gradually towards the lower value if we cannot find good running in this end. But I don't know, we have to decide. I think I'll stay with 130, just for the sport of it. Then we have to consider the air jet, the air correction jet, the top of the emulsion tube. I've made a schematic here. This is the fuel jet. At the lower end, it sucks up fuel from the vacuum out here in the main venturi. That's the connection out into the main venturi. And in here, we have the emulsion of air and fuel. Now, if we increase the diameter of the fuel jet, we get a more rich mixture here at all RPM. At the other end, if we increase the diameter of the air correction jet, we get a more lean mixture, but only in high RPM. This makes sense because, as we saw before, the vacuum is generated in the venturi and it pulls fuel through this channel here for each barrel. And at lower RPM, there's not much flow through the barrel and the emulsion tube doesn't really work as well. We also suck a lot of fuel in from what is called the idle system. We'll look at that later. So it's at higher RPM, the air correction jet really gets working and the emulsion tube really gets working. So this is a good rule of thumb. Lean at higher RPM, rich at all RPM. And it also makes sense that with a smaller diameter venturi, we get a deeper vacuum, but also more restriction in the flow. And for a race car application, we might go up to a 32, like we've chosen here, or 34 as indicated in the graph actually, to get less restriction in the flow through the venturi, but we would not have as deep a vacuum and we would not have as good an emulsion getting out from the channel here, supplying a mixture to the auxiliary venturi. Every time we make a step of 5 hundredths of a millimeter in the fuel jet, it is equivalent to a bigger step in the air jet. And this makes sense when you consider the viscosity of fuel and air against each other. There's much more sensitivity to changes in the fluid than in the gas. Right. And then we have the air correction jet. Mr. Weber doesn't say anything about picking the size, but he does say that the common range is between 1.5 and 2.3 millimeter. And if I take our fuel jet decision from before, The common range was 0.8 to 1.8, and we chose a 1.3. That's right in the middle of the range. And I take that range of 1.5 to 2.3. Right in the middle of that range would be 190 or 1.9. So that's what I'll stick with. Now, before we talk about emulsion tubes, you have to consider this. This is the rev range. Your car actually runs on what is called the progression system. It's fed from the idle jet. It's a wrong word, it's not an idle jet. It is actually a normal driving jet. And most people, when they don't really use a wide open throttle or they don't really go really fast on the engine, are actually mostly just driving on the idle system, as it is called. But I choose to call it the progression system here. The progression system fades away when the vacuum in the back of the carburetor, after the throttle flap, when it fades away and the actual vacuum begins to be created in the venturi instead. Then we have this rising curve here and the main system with the auxiliary main jet, air correction jet, and the emulsion tube system takes over and squirts sprays emulsion mixture into the main venturi. So it doesn't start until there's a proper vacuum generated, and the vacuum cannot be generated until you open the throttle and let air flow through the carburetor. Now the emulsion tube actually holds this curve down at high RPM. Otherwise, it would just go berserk in high RPM. You have to think of the emulsion tube as like a straw, sucking on a straw on a soft drink. And if there's a hole in the straw, it's difficult to actually suck anything up. This is what happens in the emulsion tube. It is a controlled way of getting that annoying leakage. So at lower RPM, it gives more fuel than it would from the vacuum that is generated in the venturi, and at higher RPM especially, it takes off a lot of richness that would otherwise drown the engine. So, does this make sense? Emulsion tube is actually the real genius of the Weber carburetor. It was copied by the Dell'Orto in the 70s, I think, or 60s. So this is important. Let's look at different emulsion tubes and talk about what actually happens inside them with this annoying straw leakage syndrome. So here we have the DCOE carburetor. You recognize the barrel here with the airflow going this way. There's the wide open throttle. And you can see the spray of mixture mixing with the clean air coming in through here. The vacuum is generated in the auxiliary venturi here, and the deep vacuum in this area of the main venturi. Right back here we have the idle screw, and nothing happens here. There's no flow through that. This is high RPM, and there's nothing sucked in here. There's a little leakage in the acceleration jet. We'll get to that later. You can see the emulsified petrol here with air bubbles from the emulsion tube. At the base of the emulsion tube, we have the main jet. It sucks up fuel from this vacuum here. It sucks it up to a higher level than what is in the float chamber. So this is petrol in the float chamber. When there's no suction here, the float chamber will let petrol up into the emulsion tube to this level. And once we go to wide open throttle and we suck here, we get this special annoying feeling like sucking on a straw of soda pop. Because on the top of top end of the emulsion tube, there's a controlled leakage. It sucks in air, and it lets the air into the chamber around the emulsion tube out through different holes. I made a little drawing over here. You can actually see the emulsion tube in black here.